I am Kirk Jowers, and welcome to the April 1st Frequently Asked Questions episode. As always, I'm joined by Dr. Russell Osguthorpe, the Chief Medical Officer of dōTERRA, and a board-certified pediatric infectious diseases specialist. Thank you for watching, commenting, and asking questions. Here are some of your most frequently asked questions. So the first question is, I've read that there are now two strains of COVID-19. Does this impact testing?
I think what the questioner is asking, Kirk, is the difference between the designation SARS-CoV-1 and SARS-CoV-2.
Right.
So SARS-CoV-1 was the virus that circulated in 2003, causing the SARS epidemic.
Right.
SARS-CoV-2 is the same thing as COVID-19.
Okay.
So they are two different viruses, both of which are coronaviruses, both of which cause severe acute respiratory syndrome, but they do not cause, they're not the same virus. They're different viruses.
Right.
And they have different tests to detect those two different viruses.
Thank you. Next question. Must you absolutely have a fever to be considered for testing? If you have two of the three symptoms plus other flu-like symptoms, could you not have it? Why is fever the deciding factor?
Okay, so I think what we're asking here is somebody's asking from a country where testing is being limited, which is most countries right now. But when there's limited testing, we test the most severe cases. And so fever is a predictor of severe disease, as is shortness of breath. So if you have severe fever, severe shortness of breath that's ongoing, you're gonna get tested. And so we overemphasize those symptoms when we say that you need to come in and get tested.
And I think that's the perfect lead-in for the final question today, which is, why doesn't the U.S. have enough tests and medical supplies to handle this outbreak? And as you mentioned in your last question, we could put any number of countries in that sentence, but let's focus on the U.S.
Well, I think that's a complex answer. It's been a series of, I would say, cascading failures at every level, from individual all the way up to government and every business in between that works in this industry. We've struggled to be prepared for this in the United States. However, there are some bright spots across the world where we can see that, for instance, the SARS epidemic of 2003 really woke some countries up, and it kind of forced or encouraged them to invest in their public health infrastructure. So in places like Germany, we've seen a different response where they've had more PPE available, stockpiles were ready and prepared. One way to look at it is to think about individuals and how well we each are at saving money for rainy days. Globally, we are experiencing one of those rainy days right now. The U.S. has not done a particularly good job of that over the last decade or so. We've cut funding to our public health infrastructure pretty significantly, making it very difficult for us to respond appropriately. And so we find ourselves having to play catch up, which we're doing really well. But I think in years to come, after this is over, we'll have a chance to prepare differently for the next rainy day. And I would say there will be another one. What we know about infectious diseases in human beings is that this is not our last pandemic. There are going to be multiple pandemics and infectious diseases that can transmit globally throughout my lifetime. The question is will we individually and as nation states be prepared for them?
Thank you so much, and thank you for being with us today.